brief introduction about myself as a part of the Stories of Evolution to Wisdom of our IIT Madras Alumni Association. First of all, let me compliment them for this initiative to sort of archive some of the life stories of the alumni. It's going to be a great treasure. My name is Dr. Pradeep Bagh. I'm a B.Tech in electronics from our IIT Madras, 1974 batch. My family comprises my wife, Netra, who is a retired lecturer. My eldest daughter is Anuya, and she is also IIT, but Illinois Institute of Technology, and works in Chicago with Motorola, her family is there. Then my son, Omkar, he is also from IIT Powai, and he is IIT JEE 37th rank, much better than what I had scored, of course. And he works in New York. Then my one daughter, Kashmira, she works for Google in Hamburg. So like any other middle class family, the children have all flown away, and we, husband and wife, are in India, enjoying the challenge of living together alone. Anyway, thank you very much for this part. I will now continue my presentation. Regarding my background, I did my schooling in a small town called Jhansi in Uttar Pradesh. Jhansi was a small town, and I was the first rank holder in the Indian school certificate examination over there. So I felt I was a big shot. But when I went to IIT JEE, I found that it was tough. And those days, there were no coaching classes, at least not in Jhansi. So, and also I, the brilliant guy of Jhansi got a fair enough rank to get into IIT Madras and the electronics branch, which was a very prestigious branch in those days. So with that, I came to IIT, and I must say that I have some very beautiful memories of the campus of IIT. My parents weren't from Jhansi, so it was a long distance of travel, almost 1.5 days to Madras from Jhansi. But the campus was so beautiful that it did not make me miss my home very much. I enjoyed the sylvan surroundings of the campus, and especially the sightings of deers as we moved around on the campus. Those are very beautiful memories I have. Regarding the academics, they were very demanding. I remember them to be very demanding. What with all those submissions and tutorials and all those periodicals, very demanding. But I enjoyed them because we had very remarkable faculties. I still remember a lot of names. I still remember the way they taught, Professor V.G. Kaishanoy, then Sharma, then Professor S. Sampath, and so many people. I still remember most of my faculty. Very remarkable. And I think they laid a strong foundation of academic understanding of the subjects for us. Importantly, I also enjoyed my laboratories, because practical work is what I felt improved our fundamentals, clarified our concepts, and helped us through. And the lab assistants were also very, very helpful. Though the batches were changing every time, but I found them, they were very good for the lab assistants. But what I enjoyed most was studying with my classmates. Very interestingly, just a day before, not even day before, I would say the night before, they would all pile into my room, because I was supposed to be a very studious guy, very studious guy. So they'll all pile into my room and then ask me to go over the whole portion. I did not like it much, but then I found that trying to explain to my colleagues, I became more clear about my concepts. So I enjoyed studying with my classmates, and I had some very excellent classmates, I would say, very good people. Regarding my favorite spots, well, the favorite spot was OAT for the weekly movies, I would say. I miss it a lot. In those days, there was no internet, no YouTube, no this and no that, no other distraction. So we had to look forward to the movies at the OAT. And I still remember how when it rained, while the faculty and all would go away, we would still continue to sit in the OAT and pick up the empty chairs of the faculty and put it on our head and start seeing the movie and keep insisting that the movie should go on. So that is some very interesting memory. But I also loved going to the temple. The temple near the gate of the campus. Weekends I used to go there, and especially I like the bhajans of Ayappa over there. Ayyappa was a new god for me, but okay. somebody had told me that every local god you must pray to, because they are the ones who are ruling over that area. So I used to enjoy those bhajans and the darshan of Lord Shiva. So these were my favorite spots. Coming to what impact IIT had on me, I would say it gave me an excellent foundation of theoretical subjects. But more than just the theoretical subject, what I found very important, was that the system of teaching over there was such that it exercised every single portion of the brain. So whether it is thinking skills, creative, analytical, abstract, whatever you say, whether it is intellectual way of thinking, whether it is presentation skills, so many things. The entire brain, I felt, was completely shaken up by the system of education in IIT. And the stay in the hostel, that was enjoyable. It gave me a sense of independence. I remember when I landed at IIT, I used to call my parents to ask them, can I buy a pen or can I buy a notebook? But slowly I learned how to take decisions myself. And over the period, what IIT gave me, if I feel, is that can-do attitude. You know, that has lasted me for the lifetime. Can do. We can do something. That has lasted me for the lifetime. Now, the next question the alumni has asked is journey to wisdom. What's up? Afterwards, what happened? The timeline. Before I tell the timeline, let me tell something. I obviously, because of my studious thing, came with distinct flying colors, distinction, this, that. But do you know who got the jobs first? It's not me. It's not the distinction holders. It was the guys who, apart from having decent grades, used to be in sports or athletics or dramatics or things like that. Then I realized what is the importance of extracurricular activities. Because that is where the entire personality gets developed. So for those, if there are any young students listening, please listen to this also. It's good to have grades, but it's also important to participate in the other activities that go on at the IIT campus. So anyway, so 1974-75, immediately after I passed out, I worked for Larsen & Toubro Mumbai. Then 75 to 77, I did my Master of Engineering in Industrial Engineering and Management from Asian Institute of Technology in Bangkok, Thailand, where I got a Government of Australia scholarship. 77 to 93, I was in hardcore engineering in Philips, in Pune. But in 93, I decided to become a social entrepreneur, which I will explain later. So what are the insights? That's what the alumni association has asked me to share with you. My insight of industry experience is that the requirements of the industry are totally different from what we learn at the academics. Totally different. And what is the difference is that industry is working on cutting-edge technology. At least in Larsen & Toubro, I found that. In Philips, I found that. They are on cutting-edge technology. So I would definitely advise students that whenever they are doing their classes, please also read up articles and latest research that is going on in your field, because that is what is actually used in the industry. Academics will always have a limitation because they take some time to adapt to new things. But I think now with IIT having also a lot of industry linkages, this aspect must have been taken care of. The second insight which I got is that it is not enough to know only your stream of education. So I was an electronics engineer, but when I got into the industry and I rose to become production manager, I found that not more than 30 to 40% of my electronics knowledge I had to use. Rest of the knowledge was chemical engineering, mechanical engineering, civil engineering, metallurgical engineering. And guess how I coped with it? Because in IIT, in the first 2 years, or perhaps even up to third year, there are a lot of foundation courses in these different course subjects. And that time we used to curse, are we kyun padhate hain mechanical engineering, mechanical drawing kyun sikhate hain? We are never going to use it. We are electronics engineers. But when you rise in an industry, I'm not talking of the IT field, where you don't need any of this engineering knowledge, especially if you are in the engineering field. When you rise higher, you have to be multiple stream oriented. And that's where I felt my IIT education has helped me. I hope IIT has maintained that discipline even now, because it's very important, especially for pure engineering careers. But the biggest insight I got was that human behavior. Human behavior, that study, nobody can teach. We had some subjects, I think, in IIT, humanities, etc. But human behavior, you have to learn on the go. You have to be open. I had about 160 engineers, supervisors, and workmen under me. Each level of communication is different. The way you communicate with your bosses is different. The way you communicate with your engineers is different. The way you communicate with your workmen is different. The way they behave is different. Everybody reacts in a different way to the same sentence which you speak to the three levels. So learning human behavior is very important, because the biggest thing you have to do is keep the whole team motivated. Imagine trying to keep 160 people motivated to work for you. I must along the way mention that I also developed a patented electronic artificial voice restorer, which was patented by NRDC. So these are my insights of industry. Now, 93 onwards, I became a social entrepreneur. It's a very interesting story. Since childhood, I had a passion somehow that I should help my colleagues. Even when I was in kindergarten, I remember I used to gather pamphlets of different careers that people can follow, and I used to share it with my friends over there. And as I reached adulthood, I was pained by the poverty and unemployment. Especially, I got affected by one particular incident. I was standing on the railway station in Jhansi waiting for something, and a train had just come in, and there was a very old beggar type of lady on the platform, very, very old. And the police suddenly came, "Are kya kar rahe hai yahan pe?" And they picked her up and threw her into that train, and then the train went off. I said, "What the hell is happening?" So I said, "Police, why did you do this?" "Oh, no, no, wo mantri sahab aa rahe hain. Minister is coming. And so we have to remove all the poor from here so that he gets a nice feeling." And I said, "What is the minister dealing with?" "Oh, garib hatao, garib hatao." I felt so bad. Is that how we treat our people? Is that how we treat our citizens? I felt very bad. And that had an impact on me. And I said, okay, I have to now leave. I have to do something in social entrepreneurship. Because entrepreneurial culture is what India needs, I felt that time. Because if there are more entrepreneurs, then more employment will be created. And for this purpose, I visited Europe. Because I said that entrepreneurship in India can be spread only if there's a use of mass media. So I went to Europe. I carried a small tape recorder with me from India. And I kept on following the television programs over there. And suddenly I found one program in Netherlands which said, "Focus on the market," which had interviews of almost 7 entrepreneurs. So I went to the studio and asked, "Hey, why are you doing all this?" They said, "Okay, when we show entrepreneurs interviews on the television, especially the young ones, other young people get confidence that, okay, enterprise is not a monster. It can be done by ordinary people like us. What kind of space is required, number of people that is required, and type of technology that is required." And they said that in over 6 years, their unemployment rate came down from 11% to 6% purely because of their programs. So this became a good guideline for me. One interesting kissa I'll tell you. So when I was returning from Europe, the customs people caught me. They said, "Hey, you have not declared this tape recorder of yours. It was a Sony tape recorder." I said, "Oh, that's on my passport." I said, then they said, "Why should anybody from India carry a tape recorder and bring it back?" So I gave them that background, that how I wanted to do some work for entrepreneurizing the Indian society and make programs on media, and how I studied them and how I recorded them. So I got a shock. That time they had already worked out a duty of 2100 rupees, which was a very big amount in 1986 for me, something like 40,000-50,000 rupees of today. That customs officer canceled that entire duty calculation and said, "Go, sir, you are going to do something for your nation. You are going to do something for your nation." You know, that struck me in the heart. So when I came out, I said, now that 2100 rupees does not belong to me. It belongs to the society. So with that 2100 rupees, I started this small NGO called Development Education International Society. And some very prestigious people that time joined me in this game. I then followed it up with research visits to schools in developed countries of Australia, New Zealand, USA, Canada, UK, and Germany. And came to know that there's a subject they teach over there which we don't even think about. It's called enterprise education. From the first standard, they teach it. It's very interesting the way they teach it. And not every school, but select schools teach it. And they say that this is required so that they will have enterprising capabilities. They said, not that every child will become an entrepreneur, but he'll be enterprising in whatever he does, either in employment, as an intrapreneur, or as an entrepreneur, which was a very good thing for me. So I developed some study material, and luckily I got an assignment from UNDP to go to the Arab region And I taught it in Morocco, Sudan, Jordan, Syria, and Algeria. Very interesting experiences I had over there. Sometime I can share with you later on. So all that which I have learned is now on the website, enterprise-education.in. It should be I-N. By mistake, I have written O-N. It should be I-N, I-N, in. Enterprise-education.in. And what I am looking forward to is if somebody would like to join hands and convert this into an interactive website or a mobile app, that will be a nice thing so that it's easy. In fact, now I teach MBA students online about enterprise-education, especially the entrepreneurship development cells. That's what I teach, mostly on a pro bono basis. The last point is extra shots. Very well thought, Alumni Association, the way you have gone about it. Very, very nicely thought flow of presentation. So about my hobbies is poetry, traveling, Rotary Peace, where I work for Rotary Peace Focus, and morning walks, yes. I'll only talk about two of them. One is, the first question that was asked in that flow is, how do I find time for all these passions? And my answer to that is, passion makes its own time. You don't have to find time for passions. Passion makes its own time. So my poetry is intuitive. Intuitive means I don't sit down and plan. Okay, Abhi, let me see. This is my subject. This is how I have to put it. There's no, so I don't write any framework for it. It just comes out from inside. And then I realize that it comes out because it has been lying there somewhere in the subconscious thinking levels for perhaps an indeterminate period of time. Sometimes I feel even from my last life, it's over there. It's, well, that's just a conjecture. Don't worry about it. So intuitive poetry it is, which is largely the blessings of my Sadhguru, or you can say great master, Chile Maharaj. In fact, after he took his samadhi, I felt that he gave me an instruction that I have to write these women's empowerment anthologies. Accordingly, three anthologies have emerged from within, I would say. I would say emerged, it's like the same way that a fruit emerges from a tree. The tree doesn't know about it. It's there, a part of nature's gift. So Sita Shakti Kavya, Radha Bhakti Sudha, and Mahalakshmi Mukti Samvad. They are all available on this website, sita-radha-lakshmi.org. I used to think, this is funny, what is this coming out and who am I writing all this? But interestingly, I made video films out of this and just sent them for some international short film festivals. And they won awards in San Francisco, New York, and in Spain. Three different places across the world. That time I stood up and said, hey, if totally unconnected juries are finding some sense in it, I must myself start reading them. So I started reading and reading them, and now I make presentations about these anthologies to different groups, largely senior citizens groups and others who are interested. The last thing is about Rotary. I work on the focus of peace. In 1617, I had organized an International Understanding and Peace Symposium. About 700 delegates from all the world attended. 32 experts from all over the world addressed it. And that laid the foundation of trying to connect with the first the countries in the subcontinent. Because I found that the peace will be created if ordinary people in the neighboring countries first tie up with each other, rather than only politicians connecting with each other. Politicians always have some kind of a ulterior motive, but at the common level, common man's level, it's no ulterior motive except being either friends or trying to help each other. So that way I got very good connections with Nepal. We also helped them with almost how many, $8,000 in a project to buy some medical equipment. And then we have some connections with Bangladesh. And we are also having in the coming days, I'm having a meeting with one of the other countries on the western side of India. Let's see how it goes. Then the second thing which I think I was successful in doing is to institute a peace award. My NGO, which I just mentioned, we have instituted this award. And every year through Rotary, we give away this award to two type of people, either those who have done some good service to people in the conflict zones like Syria or Mosul or somewhere, or Kashmir. We came to know of some doctors who went all the way in the Middle East where nobody was wanting to go and provided medical services. Funniest part, you know, the most strange part was that they were giving medical services to both the sides who were fighting with each other without caring whether he's from side A or side B. That is the type of people who are trying to restore peace in an otherwise world which is beset with so much of strife. And we also give peace awards to people who otherwise work in normal societies and who create or do humanitarian projects which sustain an atmosphere of peace. And currently, I'm the counselor of peace in my district for Rotary. That's about all. So thank you very much for the time that you gave me. This is my story of evolution to wisdom.